Welcome to the Solar Energy Channel, where you'll get an honest inside look at all things solar. I'm Warren, and with me today is Dale Good, our president and CEO, and we're going to discuss the guidelines that just came out for direct pay or elective pay about 3 weeks ago, and what you as a nonprofit need to know about filing or registering your project. So welcome, Dale.
Hey, good to be here, Warren.
Yeah. So about 3 weeks ago, on December 22nd, the IRS released these guidelines on their website. Tell us a little bit about this document.
Well, it's about 69 pages long.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of reading here, and I actually did read it. I certainly don't remember everything, and I didn't memorize it. But a lot of the documentation is guidance on how to do that pre-registration, actually on the website. So it's pretty thorough. It's pretty comprehensive. The first probably 17, 18 pages of it deal with more generic stuff as far as the process. And then you get about 40 pages of very much screen-specific directions on how to walk through it. Keep in mind that this is for multiple tax credits. This is not just for the ITC. And I imagine we're going to talk about the ITC today, Warren.
Yep.
But you can see, I mean, even on this, on the slide, it says the CHIPS Act. And of course, the CHIPS Act was for semiconductors, for U.S. manufacturing of that. So there's other, this tool is going to be used for other credits other than the solar ITC.
And we'll link in the description below a hyperlink to download this guide directly from the IRS's website. And you most certainly should download it and follow the guide if you're planning on registering a system.
Now, I completely agree with that. I mean, I have not registered a system, so I can't claim experience, but from reading through it, it's very thorough.
That brings up an important point. As with any legal or financial advice, we're not accountants or lawyers, and so always seek your professional advisors when filing tax credits or working through these elective pay reimbursements or tax credits. But just as what Dale said, we're not a nonprofit, so we haven't had an opportunity to go through the process. We probably won't have an opportunity to go through the process ourselves, and so this is something that you as the system owner will need to do with your accountant or your controller or whoever files your tax returns. You'll need to go through this with them. We're just sharing the information that we know from receiving the guide and reading through it.
Correct. Yeah. Very accurate.
Yep. So let's talk about bring some clarity. Help us understand this, Dale, the IRS codes that are referenced in this document and which ones apply to solar PV.
Well, it's really easy to get lost in IRS code speak. I mean, when you read things from the IRS, they're referring to other sections and they're talking about these different code types that are involved with this website. So solar PV has been under Section 48. For commercial, not residential. And let's be clear, this is strictly for any solar system that is considered commercial, nonprofits, et cetera, but not residential.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're under 48. 48D is different. It's for manufacturing. It does not apply to our customers of Paradise, the people who are installing solar systems. 48E is the coming one. And that's going to be a combination of various tax credits starting in 1/1/2025, they'll be under 48E going forward, and the regular 48 will go away.
Okay, great. That makes sense. All right, now, in discussing this guide is the option for nonprofits to either take advantage of the direct pay or the elective pay, in other words, to receive a check from the Treasury once their system is installed and they file their taxes 18 months or so later, or the ability to sell the credits.
Yeah, and Warren, actually, for a nonprofit, they don't qualify to sell the credit.
Okay.
They cannot sell the credit. They can get the direct pay. If they want to go any other route, they still have to use the old method of third-party ownership, PPAs. They're still available. You can still do them. But the transferability is for profitable businesses who file tax returns who may not have the tax equity.
Right.
They can sell those credits. And I did just read something recently. There's a company based in southeastern Pennsylvania called Crux Climate, and shouldn't give them free advertising. But from what I can tell, they're doing some good work around transferability. And I think so far there's been around $9 billion in transferred credits have occurred. But typically, these are strictly large systems at this point, utility scale, not the type of customers that we're typically dealing with.
Right. So it's very clear in the guide that you can't do both, but you couldn't do both regardless, because you're either a nonprofit going after the elective pay, or you're a for-profit entity that doesn't have the tax liability, or maybe you do, but you want to sell the tax credits and possibly capture that sooner.
Yeah. And the two words, direct pay and elective pay, are interchangeable. They're used both ways in the IRS code itself. So
yeah,
same thing.
Yeah. And then, regardless of whether you want to file for the elective pay or you're trying to transfer credits, you have to register the system through this process with the IRS.
Yes, correct. And you'll notice on this slide, we actually mentioned 120 days. So the IRS is advising people who are going to, you have to basically there's multiple steps here. Maybe we should have backed up to that, but you have to register the system and then you file the credit, the attempt to get the direct pay with your tax return. And you have to file a tax return. 990T is typically what's used for nonprofits.
Yeah.
That those steps have to happen. And so we're talking about the registration here. And the registration, it actually has to be preceded by whoever's doing the work, whoever's filing this, to have an IDME account with the IRS. So that's that. We're going to talk a lot about that, but that has to precede this. If you're going to actually file for this pre-registration, you have to have an IDME account.
Okay, great. So you talked about this briefly, must file a tax return form 990T for nonprofits. Many nonprofits don't file any taxes.
No. And Warren, if they don't want to file the tax return, they can't get the direct pay.
Okay.
I mean, it's that clear. I mean, they're going to have to file this 990T. And it must be timely filed. That's, you know, if you think about 100, so a lot of calendar year filers, nonprofits, typically it's May 15th. If you back up 120 days from May 15th, we're really close to that.
Yeah.
Sure. I mean, this went into effect 1/1/2023. So there could be companies, business, nonprofits that already want to file for this. And they're saying 120 days. But what you can do is you can file for an extension. And I would suggest that if you're going to do this, that's probably wise. And you go for that extension, which is 6 months, and you can get that. Governments, municipal entities, they don't have a method to file for an extension. So they automatically are giving that to them. So this year, any municipality that would be going after this, they automatically have an extension 6 months on their tax return deadline.
Sure. But if you're a nonprofit that's not a municipality, and you're filing on the calendar year and you have a project, you probably want to move forward relatively quickly here in registering that project and getting a registration number and moving the process forward. And also, if you're a nonprofit that historically has not filed tax returns or 990Ts, you're going to have to do it this year in order to get that registration number.
Correct.
Well, not to get the registration number, but to file the taxes and get the direct payment.
Right.
So we have here several steps in the these aren't the steps in the process, but some of the requirements. They need to create an ID.me account. Mm-hmm. They must have an EIN, a separate registration number for each facility, and the emphasis on the date placed in service. Do you want to walk us through these, Dale?
Yeah, well, I already mentioned the ID.me account. So
yeah,
I'll skip ahead. EIN, I think most people know what that is. So I'm going to move to the third one, separate registration number for each facility. So if somebody is filing for, say, four solar systems that they've installed, four different locations, that's four different registration numbers. It can be, it should be filed under one application, but you're filing for four different registration numbers. So that's important, because there are different ways. If there was a lot of systems, you can actually do a batch upload through an Excel spreadsheet, the way I understand it, according to the instructions, and you can only do one of those. If you do another one, it replaces the previous one. And for the year, you can only file one time for the direct pay. So you cannot file now and then in a couple months file again for the same year and then in a couple months file again. You can't do that. It's one application with separate registration numbers for each facility.
Yep.
And the date placed in service, Warren, determines which tax year you can get the direct pay for. And that's significant because of domestic pay content or domestic content impacts on the direct pay, which I think we're going to talk about here in a little bit later.
Right.
But date placed in service is important. As is the date it was started. Both dates are important.
So the date placed in service is the tax year that you're filing for. So you should know how many projects you have by the time you get to file. You wouldn't necessarily file one and then another and then another. At the end of the year, you should know how many projects you have. And then they would all be in service at that point. And then you would be filing the following year for that previous year.
Right. I think the only way that might change, Warren, is if it was a really large entity that had, you know, systems all over the country and they're doing a lot of them.
Sure. Portfolios of systems. Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yep. All right. So let's jump into the steps here. The first three steps outlined: submit a registration request, respond to the IRS if they within 60 days, if they have any notifications or changes that you need to make. And then finally you get your registration number.
Yeah. So you're going to submit it. And they're suggesting that people watch it. So once you have your account registration set up, you can go in and view the status of that. And they suggest that we do that because it's a new system. And the IRS themselves are a little concerned about, you know, is it going to be smooth, you know, working through this? There's also a place where you can sign up for email notifications. And they suggest you should do that so that if the IRS needs more information for your application, they're going to email you as opposed to you having to go look. Because if you miss their deadlines, then they throw it out. And you only have, and when they request information, you can see the statuses on the screen, actually, awaiting assignment, under review, return open. If they're needing information, you only have 35 days to respond. So if you just ignore this for a couple of months, you could actually knock your application out.
Yeah. And I wouldn't rely on the IRS to actually send you a notification. I would do both of what they're suggesting: sign up for the notifications and continuously check it to make sure that there are no requests pending.
Yeah, I would completely agree.
Yeah. Okay, so Dale, something that could throw a wrinkle in all of this is the domestic content requirement. How does that fit into the direct pay, elective pay?
Yeah, so the domestic content requirement, of course, is a 10% adder for most projects, Warren, but for direct pay, it's a requirement. Now, the caveat here is that it's for projects over 1 megawatt. So, yeah. But for projects that are over 1 megawatt, they have to have domestic content on them this year to get the full ITC. And it goes by the date that it was started, the project started. So if they started in 2023 and they complete in 2024, no problem. If they start in 2024, finish in 2024, they're going to only get 90% of the ITC unless they can prove domestic content. Again, only systems over 1 megawatt. So, and then it goes to 85% in 2025, and it goes to zero after that. So large projects over 1 megawatt a couple of years from now, they're going to have domestic content to get direct pay, or they wouldn't get anything. Most of our clients are under 1 megawatt, Warren.
Correct. So for projects that are under 1 megawatt AC, they don't have to worry about the domestic content requirement. For those that are over 1 megawatt AC, any projects that were previously installed last year are fine, but any projects starting this year will need to meet the domestic content requirements in order to get the 10% adder or even to just get the elective pay from the IRS.
And it's very difficult, Warren, to get that adder right now. There's only, I mean, you almost have to have the modules meet the requirement, and there are just not many modules that meet that requirement. And the ones that do have probably a two-year backlog to even get them. So
right. And most manufacturers are not at the point yet where they're certifying that their equipment meets the requirements of the IRA in order to get that 10% adder.
Correct. And that's because the domestic requirement thing is not very clear. I mean, most of the people that I've seminars that I've participated in, Warren, are saying they have to rewrite it. They have to do something differently with it. So we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see how that unfolds. And then finally, there is a frequently asked questions page on the IRS's website specifically for direct pay and elective pay. And we'll link this hyperlink in the description of the video below. If you have any questions, feel free if you have comments or feedback that, from us to leave that in the comment section below. And otherwise, any closing thoughts or anything we missed here, Dale?
No, I think the IRS is providing, this is a good website, Warren. There's a good Q&A here. There's a registration website that looks pretty good to me. You just have to walk through these steps. And I think if you do that, you're going to reap some rewards here because it's a tremendous opportunity for those entities that could not take advantage of the ITC previously.
Sure. So why don't we, before we close off here, just recap what we just talked about. So the registration portal is finally open. It may not show that it's open on the White House's website, but it is in fact open according to the Treasury and the link here. So your first step would be, if you're ready to register a system, if you had a system installed, to download the guide from the link and follow the process. You'll need to create an account with ID.me. You'll need to have your EIN information available, and you want to register this project as soon as possible, it's particularly if it was installed last year and you're filing according to the calendar year this year. You should do it pretty soon here in order to get give the IRS enough time to review the project. Once you get your registration number, make sure you signed up for the notifications, and then also make sure that you're frequently checking to make sure that there are no pending items from the IRS or anything that you need to update or change. And then finally, make sure that you work with your tax advisors or legal advisors to work through this.
Very good. Thanks, Warren.
Thank you, Dale. Appreciate it.